We start here because typically all of you know how to get to this point. It's some path in the manual, which Chris explained, the new one, it was interactive. We do recommend the Pro Pack. Does everybody Pro Pack their reserves for javelins? How you doing? Good to see you, Chris. We find we get the best results from that. And this is a Optimum 143 in a TJNK, so it's one size larger and it packs that much better. I'm quite spoiled. I actually get to pack the orange ones pretty much most of the time. If it's a different color, I won't touch it. I won't. I'm sorry, I'm just spoiled. But these are just a great canopy and they actually go in again one size up very nicely. So we'll start with the reduction folds. I'm back to you at certain points of the class. A lot of people go up and over, which is fine. You can actually come out and under or do a mix match of two. I prefer to go into the center because you just spend all that time getting the lines down the middle. Why disturb that pulling the canopy away from you? So what I do is I start with a D fold and this stabilizer here, this point here where it folds, because it's curved like this, this curve, this is your fold point to use that as a reference point, okay? So I just fold the top part in line with this, then I hold it, sorry Chris, pick up the next one into the center, hold it, run my hand down, fold it over, change hands, roll it out, it's quite simple. Fold it in, hold it, run your hand down, and then run your hand out. At this point, I'll flake the tail for the final time. And because we only have 50 minutes, I would like to take questions as we go, and I'll try and answer them the best I can. So please just speak up, feel free. You'll find when you actually flake the tail, it will come out equal with your reduction folds. A lot of people say they don't put reduction folds in the Optimum because it gets too thick and bulky. I disagree. I haven't found that issue. I've packed over 5,000 javelin reserves, and between about five of us at some path over the last 10 years, we all pack the same way. So that information is what you're seeing today, and it's the same stuff you're going to get on the website. If you have any different techniques or methods you think are appropriate, let me know. We can share that, of course. But typically, we pack everything the same way, from the RSK to the MJ12, which is like a tandem rig. It gets packed just the same. So we do the same on this side. I'm going to use that as my reference point here. Folding the top part of the D. And what we do find as we give classes around the country is that it's the little things you see we do that makes a difference to your pack job. It's nothing drastic. So if you're packing right now with a 3-inch loop, and I'm packing right now 75 millimeters, I'm packing right now with a 53 millimeter loop, don't go home and go too short too quick because something's going to give. You know, don't make it difficult for yourself. What you see today, just if you're going to tweak or change what you do, do it slowly, gradually. You'll enjoy it better and get a better result. Do the same this way. Again, flake the tail for the last time. I tuck the stabilizer under the D-fold and then the lines and the seams. And you feel like a trough through here, like a valley where it sits nice and quietly. Mr. Ruffle, how are you? There's always a heckler in the back. It's always Dave. Okay. All right, now, everybody good with this point so far? Okay, good. It could be neater. Normally we have tension at both ends, but I apologize for that. Okay, I use 7 tools when I pack. People use clamps, and that's okay. If you're taught with clamps, that's great, but let's say you forget a clamp or you lose a clamp. Can you still pack? Do you feel confident? Why make it difficult? So I use 7 tools. I use 2 paddles, a wooden one, and an aluminium one. I had to think about that. And aluminium. This one never uses a pull-up cord. If you have one paddle, make sure it's probably this one, because this will crack and ding and split. And you're going to see me get kind of in a good aggressive way with the material with this paddle to get it into the free bag, which is the million-dollar move you're going to see in a few minutes. So I'll use this paddle for the first fold. And what my goal is to get all the canopy in the free bag. There's a lot of people out there still who think to leave some outside here because, oh, we can go around the AAD unit and that will hide that. Or we'll go bigger here, it'll be lighter in the ear. What happens is that the reserve container is this dimension in length. So if we add 2 inches, even an inch, what it does, it pushes this forward and it pushes the AAD unit into the main container, which is the conflict, and it also starts to load the riser covers. So the idea is to get it all in if it's a compatible size. If it's not, you shouldn't be packing it. Any questions? Okay, when I talk about the grommet line, I'm talking about that line there. You see that? And you'll see this on the new interactive videos and websites. So from there, I'm going to make an S-fold. If I had a MicroRaven or a Smart below a 150, I would not put the first S-fold in because there'll be nothing to put in the ear. But with all PD canopies, I would absolutely put the first fold in. And I put my back to you again, I apologize. What I'm thinking about now is actually the AAD unit. I need somewhere for it to go. So I spread the line grips with my finger in between. I make the S-fold. This allows my grommets to come up and go back. They will migrate forward. But now there's a pocket here for the AAD unit. Most riggers think, you know, I'm going to struggle going to get it into the bag. So I'm going to fight, I'm going to curse, I'm going to kick, I'm going to sweat, get it in the bag. They think it's finished at that point because then you've got to get in the container. Well, if you kick it in the bag, guess what? You've got to kick it in the container. So why not do step A, B, C, and D consecutively and get it easier for yourself? So when you get to there, the grommets are flat. A lot of people pack them when they're up like this way. It's a steel wall. The AAD unit's going to hit the grommet and push it into the main container. It's not very good. Bring the tail down. And what I do is I take the edge of the center cell, I take a pinch at the join, I come down up to the nose, around, and I'm trying to make a nice square corner because this is really a square corner. This is what I'm using with my gauge. Do the same on the opposite side. Any questions? You're a quiet bunch. Do the same here, again. Then what I do is I work away, keeping tension going that way as much as I can. So I've
got a moment on underneath your knee, and that relates to the width of the
free back.
Okay.
It's going to get,
and it's a bit wider, a little bit.
I aim to go a little smaller because it's going to grow. This material, this behaves so nicely. It's like those clothes you buy where don't get wrinkles or create memory. That's this product. I mean, I'm not technical with canopies, but this is great to pack every time. A lot of canopies, like a blue or black, red, they're bulky. They're like a brown paper bag. You screw it up and you let go of it and it grows. And that's what a lot of canopies do. This one won't. But ideally, you always want to make the canopy or the cocoon smaller because by the time you get to put it in the bag, it's going to start to grow. Okay, so I work forwards. And what I do is I use my arm what's locking everything off, and with my free hand I take the center cell and I wrap it around the reduction folds up to the nose, work down under my knee, keep tension, change hands. It's not glamorous being a rigger. Okay, and again do the same on the opposite side, and I keep working it, keeping tension. Again, I'm getting narrower and narrower. This will be the last one. Okay, then, 1, 2, 3, fold it over your finger, make an S-fold, slide it underneath. Do the same on the opposite side, 1, 2, 3. If you count 4, start again. Okay. Now, this is the biggest tip I can give you for this point here. Keep your knees at this point here, right on the edge of the canopy, on the trailing edge. And then lock your wrists to your knees. If your hands start to walk, what we're looking for is this grommet point. Here. We're aiming for this. So if my hands move forward, the grommet point moves forward. We don't want that. So you'll see in a minute. This is the long split ear. Now I'm thinking about the bridle and the pilot chute. Now between the RSK and again the MJ12, there's two things that don't ever change. Any idea what they are? Sorry? Yep, and more vodka. And
size of the pilot chute?
Yes, same. So with the larger rigs, it's much easier to actually hide stuff. With the smaller rigs, you have to be more accurate. It's more difficult, of course. Excuse me a second. Okay, so locking your wrist to your knees. Does everybody split the center cell, or is this something new to a lot of people? It's okay if it's different. So, someone want to bag this for me? Okay, here we go. So lock your wrist to your knees, follow the seam. And I do it a couple of times. If you start to move material from the sides, move your fingers forward. You do not want to pull that around to the back. This is just the top skin of the center cell. Working all the way, take your time. It's easy with this, it's orange and white. If it's white, excuse me, and white, it can be difficult. There's a center cell, okay? You can, if you wish, gently rotate these out and go again, keeping your wrists on your knees. This is a skyhook rig. Anybody practice a skyhook rig yet? Anyone have any issues with a skyhook rig? This would be an easy class. Yeah. So I'm going to pull this back to my grommet point because my fold's going to be along this line. Now what I do, again, is I take tension from my knees on the top skin. I just catch the top part of the nose. It freaks a lot of people out. This is where people use molar straps too. If you use a molar strap, anybody use a molar strap? You do? I would get rid of it. Okay? That really is nothing else to say. It's not necessary. And then I roll that down, holding the top part open. This is my now roller strap. It's actually rolled down and quite tight. It's going to contain the parachute. Now I treat each long ear as a separate canopy. So I put my knee in the center. I don't care about that one. I bring this back in line because I want to work in a straight line, 90 degrees. It's no good working with it out here. Where most people get tired, if you're packing as your professional rigger, you're doing 2, 3, 4, 5 pack jobs a day, you're going to get tired because a lot of people do this and they get tired and they sweat. I mean, it's warm in here today. But the more gentle you are, the easier it is. It's just gently take it and dress it and make your ear. The less you play with it, the better off you are. Okay, so there's our first ear. Now, on this grommet line, I'm going to put my thumb where that would be. So this distance between the trailing edge and my thumb is going to double between my thumb and my hand here. Does that make sense? Okay, so I can adjust it. So what I'm going to do is, under tension, push the grommet line down, lift this up, bring it back, and drop it very squarely in line with the trailing edge. A lot of people twist it. The bag's not that shape. Okay, keep it straight. And put my knee on it. We're good. Take the other side, bring it back in line. That's this line here. Again, cocoon it like a main parachute. Be gentle with it, take your time. Don't get too physical, you get tired. Remember, this parachute didn't wake up trying to kick you in the butt today. It hasn't got a brain, but a lot of people take them and chuck them because it beats them. But it's a fabric. Just take your time with it. Any questions? Again, my thumb's gonna go on the grommet line like it is here. I'm gonna pull up under tension, bring it straight back, adjust, and bring it straight down on the trailing edge. And they're pretty even, which is good. Okay, now, I suggest when you make this next ear that this is all you have. So from the grommet line up, that's the ear you're gonna put in. Load the ear up as much as you can, get it really firm. You're looking for consistency through the whole pack job. We don't want any mushy areas because we want it all inside the free bag. So I always start with the right one, and I really do choke this one off because it will get bigger. There's my ear. It's quite solid. You can feel how dense that is. Take your knee off, pick it up. There's my nose. Do you see it? Slide it inside so it doesn't inhibit the nose. Put it back down. Do the same with the opposite side. There's my ear. Take my knee off, lift it up. Here's my nose. Now this is the same size as the free bag. So the goal is to put the free bag over the canopy. You can pretty much do it, that's why I have a paddle. People who try and put the canopy in the free bag could possibly lose it. Now the reason why we've got the split ear is because we need room to hide the bridle and the pilot chute. If we do the second S fold, we start to make a sandwich and it gets longer and longer and higher. Because of that, your loop's got to be longer. Well, what does that affect? Sorry?
Shapes and
force. Yeah, I mean, once you get the spring like an inch higher than it should be, you lose a lot of that power, the force. It's about 20% of the launch. And if you're at Cypress activation altitude and you've just lost a fifth of the power of the spring, it's not going your way. Also, if that loop's long, it affects the main container and the reserve container with the number 3, the tuck-in flap. And I'll show you that in a few minutes. So now, this is the hard bit. I'll give someone $100 if they bag it. I know you can do it. Right, here we go. So I start with the right ear. Get as much as you can in. Like this. Okay, what I do is I put the bag to the floor, I pick up the canopy, and I slide it under. Pull it across and contain it. The next side is actually quite hard. So if you see me struggle, it's normal. Get as much as you can in and try and get past the grommet point. Like so. Hold the canopy, pick up the bag, slide the bag around the canopy. Like that. And that is quite normal for a pad job I'm doing, keeping it outside the bag. Okay, now it gets easy, okay? You guys probably aren't gonna see. If you wanna move over there, you're welcome to. Any questions so far? No? Okay. Huh? I'm good, sorry. You good? Okay, now, before I go any further, I wanna check my grommets because I'm thinking about closing the container. I don't wanna struggle down there any more than I have to. So I look inside, my grommets are still flat and they're still separate. So that's good. If they're not, you can push them back. Okay, so I feel comfortable with that, so I'll continue. This is how most pack jobs are. They look this way when you get them out of the container. Do you agree? Mm-hmm. No? Okay. Okay. Now, when you take the first line bite, if you pull it together too close to the canopy, you move the grommets together like this and they come forward. So leave yourself a little slack. It won't matter too much. And you can start left or right, it doesn't matter. About this much. And then do the same with the opposite side. Just talk amongst yourself for a few minutes.
Question of long ponder.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any reason not to split the stoves?
Split the stoves? So yeah. Uh-huh, yeah. It's a continuous stove. Why do you think it's continuous? If you have two stoves that are independent, one could stay locked. Once this goes, if one side goes, it's actually designed where it comes through the channel and it releases anyway.
But if the first one locks, the second one will go.
If you have two stoves.
Now, like that. If that first one locks,
uh-huh.
It's not going to go.
Correct. But I've never in, I can think of 25,000 pack jobs, ever heard of it locking. Mm-hmm. Unless it's rigged incorrectly. Yeah. I mean, all manufacturers, I think apart from the racer, do pretty much a single stove, safety stove. Yeah,
and it's one. It's,
sure.
If you've got the separate ones, mm-hmm. One locks, the other one will go, uh-huh. And the loop will come through.
That's what this does.
Not if the first one locks.
No, not if the first one locks. But if you had two independent stoves, you can get one undone. You might not get the second one undone. But I've never heard of not undoing if they're correctly packed and correctly rigged. This elastic is one of the only items we would not allow any master rigger in the US or anywhere in the world actually to make themselves,
right.
Because of the calibration on it. It's very simple. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, now I'm with you.
So whichever,
both
which
sides of the loop at the same time.
Yeah. So if one, say the left one locks, the right one will release, but then the loop is free to travel.
Mm-hmm.
If the right one locks, left one releases, the loop is free to travel.
Mm-hmm.
So whichever side, it's like a win-win situation. Whereas that one, if the first one locks.
Have you ever known it's a lock?
No. Well, it's a question, that's why. It's something I've pondered for a long time. When
yeah, I mean, I think it's a great question.
It makes sense to split them, but I don't.
Normally the simple answer is the best. If it's not broken, don't fix it. I mean, we've got 45,000 containers out there, and I've never heard, even with the other manufacturers, of that issue in this situation. But it's a good question. As far as us changing what we do, probably not. I can honestly say that. It's a huge TSO change. It's a lot of money, but this is not broken, so we wouldn't change it. Any other questions? Okay, now this is the fun bit. Your paddle needs to be soft. You know, you can't have hit the dog with it, you can't have done anything with it because, you know, put it into the free bag to actually move the material around. And actually, I'll turn this way so you can see it. So what's gonna happen? I'm gonna put the paddle into the free bag. I'm gonna rotate the paddle into the lower ear and push the ear into place. I'm gonna come back out, pick up the first S-fold and help the canopy go back in. I'm gonna do that side to side until I get all the fabric in the best I can. So it's actually fabric management, and it's going where I want to put it. It's actually just manipulating the folds I made earlier into the free bag to fill this space. And hopefully this much is this much, so it's equal. If you got a small gap here and a lot out there, you should probably start again. Any questions? Okay, so it's pretty simple. Okay. All right, so to make it easy, I push this down because I want the canopy to go under the binding tape. So push down this area, take your paddle, okay, making sure that it's not going to hurt you or hurt the fabric. Slide it down, make sure you can see the paddle. That's the important part. I'm going to rotate it into the lower ear, and it drops in, and slide it down. I'm going to come back out and go into the first S-fold here and help slide that back in. Then I'm going to start again on the other side. You shouldn't keep rotating the bag for obvious reasons, unless you don't like the person who you're rigging for. Okay. Right. Again, you turn the paddle into the ear, take the ear, and push the ear down. Come back into the first S-fold. And just keep going till you keep filling up that bag. Everybody tried this method before? Is it new to anybody?
Yeah.
It's new? Yeah, this is a $100 move right there. It is. Without this, I couldn't do it. But take your time. I mean, on the free bag, if you can get it in here easily, you'll find it's going to be a dream. Because we've got the split ear, we can actually go through the center. You're going to find it easy to close the container. And that's what it's all about, keeping it simple and keeping it easy the whole way through the patch up. So because I got the long split ear, I can go in from this direction, rotate, find the ear, push the ear into the bottom. You see? Without struggling. And I'm getting closer and closer to closing the bag, and I'm not taking too much effort. I'm actually sweating because of it's hot in here, but that's the only reason. Take your time. Again, going from this side. Find the ear. You have to feel for it. Slide it down. Any questions? Find the ear. Push it down, come back in. Now, when I get to here, it's quite consistent all the way through. And that's what we're looking for. With the skyhook, the biggest thing you need to look out for now is that this area here stays open. You get a slight radius with the fabric, and you really want to get it, once it's in the container, again, push that to the outside, because you want this channel as open as you can to get the plastics of the first two flaps down. Now you've got a skyhook and a skyhook soft flap to actually incorporate into that height in there. And most people, when they pack and find it difficult, is they rotate the free bag over the skyhook and the loop becomes very short, and that's quite common. Okay, so from here, I'll put my knee in the center, trying to make room now for the pilot chute, because it's what I'm thinking about next to the bridle, the AED, and the pilot chute. And I'll just try and close the free bag by rotating the top S-fold in, like that. So ideally it can do this. Do you guys see that? Okay, it's gonna grow again. Just keep working it. So I'm pretty good, I'm pretty comfortable with that as it is right now. We want the grommets on top of the grommets if you can. You don't want any separation between the grommets. You don't want the canopy to be bag stripped on the back of the reserve container. That's not good for anybody. Okay, so from here, I use one line protector. There's one less tool to think about, and it might be small. Actually, I'm going to turn here, so you guys can see. This is not normal, of course. I go over the top of the line group. Some people go underneath, which is okay. It doesn't matter, but what happens when you go underneath, you disturb the lines removing this product, okay? So be careful. Open up just the Velcro you need so you can cover it. Velcro will eat up your line just by looking at it. Over the top. Like so. Okay. S-fold the lines, figure eight, sorry, into the pocket. Make them as wide as you can. You don't want to create bulk in the center. We're trying, the whole process is to keep the bulk to a minimum, distribute it where we need it, so it's to our advantage. So I start with leaving my thumb in the center, and I push that one down out of the way. Some riggers at some path use a tool to help them. That's okay if you do. I never have, so I didn't try and change. You guys have any questions? How are we doing for time? I don't rig anymore. But typically, probably about 4 to 5 a day. I just get very current and come and do these shows. But I keep my hand in, I stay current. I probably do about 10 a month. Because what we do is that it's not just rigging. I've built containers most of my professional life in the industry. And we actually feel how things are fitting. You know, we don't just send it out and hopefully it works. We actually need to know what's going on in the production line to make sure what we're making is compatible with the canopies. So we always at least try and do 5 or 8 a month for engineering to make sure we're getting the product we want. But we do have a full-time master rigger who actually does, his name is Ben Harris. He does all of the rigging, unless he gets busy. Yeah. Okay, so I can come straight across the top without disturbing the lines. Take off a little bit of the protector and then gently cover up the hook. So I'm happy with it. Okay, good. Any questions so far?
What's your wooden paddle made out? What sort of, is it a hardwood?
You know, I don't know the answer. I buy it from Paragear. Probably a softwood. It's probably pine. You can look at it.
About it splintering and doing some damage.
I've used that for years, and I never had an issue. Okay, thank you.
The way you've gone from there so far, you said, you know, you use as minimal tools as possible. Could you not argue that you don't need a tool to get the canopy into the bag?
Yeah, it depends on the size. There's many sizes, and I would suggest from the J1 and up, if it's an Optima, you really don't need a paddle to get it in there. It's just the smaller ones, and it does make life a lot easier. Yeah, and again, this is muscle memory for me. That's what I use, and I've always have, and I know what I can get. The results are good. But you can, yeah, if you've got the right canopy. I hope it's not too small, because it's got to be compatible, but yeah, they can go in a lot easier. But you'll find with a smaller range, you need the help if you need it. Okay.
It just goes against my sort of like train of thought to think, right, once the canopy's in there, and then add something else to the canopy free bag.
What are you adding? But yeah, you're making room for the next 2 or 3 steps. That's why you're making it easier for yourself. You could just put it in there and hope for the best, but then you're going to struggle getting the side flaps and the skyhook in place. And that will keep the pop top high, and your loop will be probably too short. So actually manipulating the fabric all the way through from the beginning to the end to make sure that this part of the process is actually quite easy. And that's the beauty of it. It really is. Okay. 53 millimeters. I don't pre-stretch it. I used to, but I don't anymore because I want that give if I need it a little bit. I don't want to stress the loop. While we're talking about loops.
You're talking 53
from the washer.
The washer.
Yeah, from the top of the washer up to the loop. AirTech, if it's a Cypress, I recommend using their Cypress pull-up cord. That's great. Always follow the manufacturer recommendations. Me personally, not some part, but personally, I will use a 1,000-pound Spectra because our AAD cutter is on the floor plate. We do not need to go through the cutter itself with the pull-up cord we're going to use. And what we find is it's an advantage because it keeps the loop from getting stressed. It keeps it a lot more open so you can pin it a lot easier. I know we haven't got a lot of time, so I'm going to keep talking as I do it. But the temporary pin you use, unless you buff these out regularly or you make sure they're soft, you can actually damage the loop without seeing it. And I've seen reserves come out on planes, people exiting aircraft, because this tool was used incorrectly with a tension tool through the kind of the debrief of the rig, and the loop actually was broken from the pin, and you can do that. So be careful with the tools you use, make sure they're in good condition. But I use a 1,000-pound Spectre to help alleviate the tension on the pin and the temporary pinning. Okay, so I'm set up for a skyhook. This is our skyhook subflap. Here's our red lanyard into the pocket. Everybody's packed a skyhook before, first time for anybody? Okay, there's a warning, an information label back here if you forget which the routing goes, but you can use this or check the website or give us a call. Okay, so from here, get the container flat. I gently just rotate the bag to the back of the container. A lot of people are timid about doing that. You're not going to hurt anything. And then from here, I can actually dress my risers. Oh, my brake's not set. Okay, it goes under the subflap here, the 6A we call it. It's actually a floating yoke. Do the same on the opposite side. Check that brake. Okay, what I do to keep my risers tight over the shoulder or through the yoke is I pull the yoke forward, keeping the plastic of the tuck tab flat. If you have an O or an A yoke, it's very difficult and you can break the plastic. And with the larger yokes, the B, C, and D, you can actually do this quite easily. You just pull this out flat and you can put your knee on it. Now, if you guys break the plastic, it's pretty tricky because you're in trouble. You haven't got any Nylotron or the right size. You need to get it from us, probably. If I break it, I just want to cross to the other building and get a new one. So, but I've never broken a plastic, and I've never known one broke at some path. So pull it out if you can. Put your knees on it. It will hold it flat. This now, sorry, I've got my back to you. Now you can push these, the number three flap, the Skyhook sub flap, and the pin flap between your knees out the way, and you can see what's going on. Fan the risers. Take the rear riser with a toggle and put it on top of the floor plate. That alleviates the bulk in your back and it carries the load. At this point, Chris, would you push me those over, please? At this point, I will go with the 1,000-pound Spectra. I also check that my loop is through my cutter. Now, do you guys change the closing loop every time, or do you do it when you think it's necessary? Why is it a good reason to do it every time? There's three main reasons to do it every time. Can you think of them? Sorry? Well, if you make the loop yourself, it's the length you want. Then it's also brand new, and you put it through the cutter. You didn't rely on somebody else to do that part for you. There's a situation in America where the rigger didn't put it through the cutter. The skydiver died. Then the rigger said he was never instructed and didn't know he had to go through the cutter. Okay, so I check on through the cutter. That's why you get all the extra paperwork with AirTech now. So I'm through the cutter, I set it up, and on here is another little tip. This binding tape on the side of the free bag, I'm going to use it as a ledge. I'm going to push my fingers and push it down as I go, working it into the container. And I'm going to work it all the way down to that stitch row, which is the reserve container sewn to the back pad. That's how it would be. Do you see that? See there? Okay. Again, take your time, do a little bit at a time, work your way down. You can take, this is called the A, B, C, D, and E flap. You can take it, fold it back into the main container, it stays out of the way. And again, take your time with the free bag. You spent all that time getting into the free bag nicely. Just again, take your time putting it into the container. Work this corner, you want to fill this corner. You can push the Cypress or the AED unit back into the pack job, what you made room for earlier. Okay, now it's time to set the Skyhook. Okay, so what's new on the manual is that if you didn't have a Skyhook, you would take the Skyhook sub flap and tuck it under the floor plate. And then all the bridle would go on top of these two flaps. We've changed that. That's the biggest thing we've changed in the last 6 months. We want you to put, regardless if it's Skyhook or not, we want the bridle half underneath and pretty much half on top, leaving 5 foot extended. So it's one way to pack all systems, the Legacy, the Odyssey, Skyhook or not, and you'll see that. So, it's typically four, but I'm gonna go up to the Skyhook. I find it's much easier to do this without temporary pinning anything because it's much more difficult with the load on the Skyhook soft flap if you pin this flap in place now. So I've got a lot of bulk here on this Type 4. There's like three layers. And I'm thinking about bulk. You can go 50-50, but I can just take one and put it across and leave these three here or four because this actually equates to the same thickness as these. I mean, that's what we kind of try and fine-tune, but only on the smaller ones. On the big ones, it doesn't matter. And if you want to divide it equally, that's fine. But we're thinking about keeping things even. Okay, so now I will actually take the green loop and set it into the Type 3 pocket. Normally, once it's gone once, it's quite easy. You can take a temporary pin to help you if you wish, just be careful you don't damage. And feel free to come around and sit where you wish to see. Okay, situate that all the way down. Okay, then the important part now is the red lanyard comes, as in the diagram, over the top of the bridle onto the skyhook. This plastic's called Lexan. You can push it apart with your fingers. If it breaks, call us. We can send you retrofits what slide on. So open that out, slide on the red lanyard onto the skyhook, like so. And at this point, I actually tie it with safety thread. Now, why do you think we tie it with safety thread? Okay, what else could we tie it with? I was in Brazil 2 years ago, and the head rigger, the chief of the federation, said that he had a tandem rig. He just packed, and 5-cord is a 40-pound thread we use for making harnesses. So they decided, oh, you know what? But they don't want it to come off, so we're going to make it so it doesn't come off, and they tied it with 5-cord. That's fabulous, because then you can't land a pilot chute, because it will not disengage if it needs to. It works two ways, skyhook or non-skyhook, regular sequential deployment. So because of that, we found out that in Brazil, and I've only ever seen it in Brazil, they use fishing line, wax thread, and 5-cord. So leave the R&D to the manufacturers. If you have an idea, share it, but don't try something new, because you've got to see the big picture. Okay, so it's like a 4-pound safety tie. Any questions on that? It goes through the hole on the other side. No, not on ours, no. Okay. No, you don't at all.
Was that the case?
I think the UPT did. I'm not sure that we did it. And then it's a surgeon's knot. Now, sometimes a thread breaks. Sometimes the skyhook disengages. If you get your rig and toss it in the back of your car because you're in a hurry, really, you really can't control that. So be careful with it because it can come off. Okay. Leave a good tail on the thread, like so. Any questions so far? Is Dave Ruffle still in the room? He got bored and sneaked off? Did he? Okay. All right. At this point, I will then set this in place. Okay. Before I close my side flaps, you can see how my ears have come together. There's no gap here anymore. It's critical I get some sort of gap to make it easier for these next two steps. So I'll take my wooden or my metal paddle, but typically the wooden one, and I'm going to push this ear down into this bottom corner, separating it, making a hole for the pilot chute and the bridle, just like this. I'm going to clear this area here out too, so I can get the side flaps to come down where I want them. So do you see the hole we have here now? Like that? That's for all this to go in. That's why you have an advantage with a long split ear. With a second S-fold, you start to go up. And then it compromises this flap, which compromises the main tuck flap. Okay. All right, so. Gently, I put my knee on the skyhook. Close the wearer's left first, it's this side. This is called the dog ear, we take that out of the way. If you leave it inside, it's pretty tricky to get out afterwards. So get it out now. I put my thumb in the gap, pushing the free bag that way as I pull the side flap over my hand. This side's the easy side. Put your knee on it. The next side's a bit trickier. And I would use my metal paddle to actually assist me in pulling. Again, pull that across, push it away. And temporary pin. Okay, any questions there? No? You guys are smiling like you have a great big ratchet at this point. Is that what goes on? Okay. So just...
Is there any absolute left or right first?
Or yeah, it's left. Wearer's left first. It's always the wearer. So it's my right, but it's the wearer's left. And that's just to keep consistency. It doesn't change function. It's just to keep, we just got to stick with one method, and otherwise it's like, they said this, they said that. Okay. Again, now I've got my side flaps, I can go back in here again. And I can actually make that hole because it closed. I'm always working on thinking ahead of the next step, which is now my pilot chute, really. So I want that hole to be as big as it can be. And by doing this, you're also taking less load off this loop too. So there's quite a big hole still there, which is great. Okay. This is the line protector flap. It just protects the lines. Slide it in the best you can. Now the method you're going to see for the pilot chute, I've done, most of my pad jobs. And honestly, it was developed by Dave Ruffle, because back in the day, we were trying to out-rig each other in the back. It was raining. We were trying to be, you know, cooler, tighter, quicker. And he came up with this method, and I've used it and served the riggers at some part ever since. And I don't know any better way of getting the pilot chute to the back with as minimum bulk as you can. So what you do is this. Let's fold the bridle. Just check you still got your sky hook in place. You can keep looking at that. It's good. You're going to find that the bridles differ in length possibly by up to 2 inches. It's part of our tolerance in manufacturing. Otherwise, there'll be a lot of rejection. It's not necessary for the bridle. But I like my base of my pilot chute to stop right on the grommet so I can just sit it straight up. A lot of people put a small S-fold in here and have this thing going on. I don't like that. It still functions well. The first thing is function. That's the most important. Second is looking good. You know, and in some path we want, you know, fit, form and function, looks good, and it works properly. So I now will make sure I kind of close, which I am. I have no idea why that's on there. Yeah, if it was necessary, we would put it on there, but we didn't deem it necessary 20 years ago, so. It's like doing a live cooking show. You never know what you're going to get. Okay. So, what I'll do, because of the thickness here, this is tri-folded, so it's 6 layers of bridle here, opposed to my 4 here. So I don't need to separate 50-50. I'm just going to take this and I'll set it to one side. Now, the important thing here, and again, it's just aesthetics, it's not function, is that on my pop-top, we're going to run late. On the pop-top, there's a runoff stitch of the binding tape, and if you have a pinstripe, there's one opposite. Ideally, you want to hide that between these two flaps so it's not offset. It helps with the grain line so it looks nice when you've finished. So give it attention to detail, then your customers will come back every time. So I'm good there. Another little tip is there's two bar tacks here and here. Do you see these two bar tacks? Okay. Keep your bridle inside the two bar tacks. We're going to create a tension crease in a few minutes, which is like a door that comes down on the side flap. And we're going to keep our bridle and pilot chute inside that doorway as such. If the loop's too long, we can't create the tension crease, and it goes against us. That's why you see pilot chute coming out over time, and then the riggers answers well, it settles, and that's what happens. That's not true. I've seen rigs packed for 10 years, what we've done, and they look just like the day we packed it. So, any questions, guys? Riveting, isn't it? Okay, so go through. Okay. I stand the pilot chute straight up. I check my runoff stitch is going that way, which it is, so I like that. Now, another little tip, and again, it's only small, but I've done rigging on tile floors, wooden floors. At this point, the rig starts going that way real fast, and you start praying for someone to come in, even the dog, or the wall to come up and help you. It's really simple. Take your knee and put your knee on that flap. It can't go anywhere. A small little thing, but, you know, we're here to help. So, when I look through here, there's two things I'm looking for. Any idea what they are? And I'm centered on the grommet, exactly, yes, exactly that. With that being said, I'll push the pilot chute down at an angle. If I go straight down, the bottom can kick out and bend the spring, and we really don't want that. So keep your knee on the pin flap cover. The rig will not go that way, hopefully. Push it down. Take all the fabric out of the coils. You want everything out. Okay, good. Then I use my tension bar or crank. This is solid. It doesn't close at the end, which is an advantage. It's also a long length. So I can pack any size container I mean, it's only ever javelins, but it works on all sizes. When you have those small ones, it can get pretty tricky. They get in the way of the container. But this one's long enough so I can actually work quite easily. Now, making sure all the fabric's out, take out your temporary pin. Take it out without too much load. You don't want to pinch this between the grommets of anything at all. You want to keep it nice and shiny without any scars or nicks. And what I'll do is I'll put my knee back on this flap, and as I turn the tool for the crank, I'm going to tap gently. When I rigged all day long every day, I'd use a dead blow hammer because it was just so much, it was easier, but I don't anymore, so I just use my fist. And I just gently just help it sit as I pull the loop through. And just pull through enough, don't pull out too much, you'll stretch the loop. Now, if I just packed this rig and there was no AAD and the customer came in and said, oh, Tom, I've got an AAD, can you put it in? Absolutely, I'll put it in. What else am I going to do at the same time? I'm going to change the loop because the loop's already too long at this point. Once you open the container, the loop's too long. It will never go back the same, okay? This is called the fingernail test. I can just get my fingernail under the pop top. Yeah. You see, if I get my finger under it, I'm going to go back and start again. Why continue when I know it won't be what I want? You know what I mean? Okay, so from here, I'll turn my back to you, I'm sorry. This is the Dave Ruffle technique. If he's in the room, he can get all the credit, but it works really well. So, you take your knee and put it on the back of the pop top. It's going to kick the pop top up like this. It gives you room. You have a big hole there for the pilot chute to go into, so you know you're actually going to successfully finish the patch job. Put your knee on the pop top, pick it up, bring all the fabric over your knee. Again, you can see the skyhook still activated, it's still good. And you'll check it again before you close this flap. Push the mesh down, under the pop top and around. Down, can you guys see? Under the pop top and around. And just keep going until you run out of material. Just like that. Now, I come to this side, I pick up this side. I put my knee on it, it lifts it up. The important thing here is to keep your hand in the middle. Do not cheat and grab all that material, you create bulk. So leave your hand here and just tease the mesh first, and the F111 will follow. Do you see how it pulls around? The only place where it's attaching is where it's sewn in production. There's nothing under there in the spring at all. When I get to here, I put a small twist like that, and I actually push that down with my knee to secure it. I'll turn the rig around for your advantage. Again, a lot of the processes you see me moving around don't typically happen at some path. Okay, so now I'll move my pin. I'm gonna remember which way I moved the pin, because as you turn the pin, the loop gets smaller. I was in Australia 2 years ago, and they're a lot different to you guys. They actually wanna get down with their beer and show you how they do it, which is great. One guy showed me how he kept the bridle in place with a pin, and he turned it. And I was like, oh man, and my boss is at the back going, oh, Tom's gonna freak out. And I just took a deep breath, and I had to start again because I couldn't get the pins in. It was terrible. So anyway, I'm gonna go to the right, which is fine. Again, over the knee. Keep your hand in the middle. I push the bridle down, and I just tease the mesh first. Not from here, but from here. And everything will follow. Do you see that? Can you guys see? Is that something new for you guys? Okay. And again, put my knee on it. Now my knee's there, I'm gonna keep it. I'm gonna make a T shape with the rest of the pilot chute. I'm not really gonna care too much about it. I'm gonna pull the A, B, C, D, and E flap over the top. Now, the pop top, get that come out. The pop top will have actually gone towards the yoke by about 1/4 inch. So the trick is, come on. Dare do that now. The trick is to actually push the pop top back to help you line up the grommets. Any questions, guys? It's a quiet group. You should have got drunk and come in. Okay. And again,
The ears that you've got right now, I tend to fold them away.
That's fine. Flap,
so
absolutely. Yes.
The kind of, there's kind of random element to stuffing something.
You're quite right. There is. Controlling it.
And
you can. Absolutely. On the large ones, I will do that. Pretty much on the J1 down, I won't. I've started to get my tension crease, but you're quite right. You've got more control if you can actually do that than if you have the room to do it. Typically, I don't. I use the paddle, but you are right. It's more random the way I'm about to show you. So again, pull this flap down, push the pop top up, and up like that. And again, get the tension device. Anybody use a ratchet or one of those cranks? No one? You're all telling the truth, right? And again, don't put too much tension on the temporary pin. Give it a little tap, take your pin out, and you'll find the loop comes through quite easily. Just gotta find it. Okay, from here, turn the rig so you can see it. You can actually right now inspect again the sky hook that's in place before you bring this flap over the top. So you can check that's all good before you go any further. And some systems you can't. And that's looking good, which is fine. These are the dog ears. A lot of people think these are to make the free bag fit in the container. If you haven't got the free bag in the container at this point and the free bag's up here, these aren't gonna help you no matter how hard you push, okay? I guess some of you tried that method. It gets you out of trouble, but it's not really what it's designed for. It's actually to stop dust and debris getting into the container. Over the years, this flap's got wider because we're trying to cover the free bag because riggers in the field aren't taking as much time as they could to actually make it look properly. Okay, do the same with the other side. Now, while it's off the ground, I'm actually going to give it a little tap here. So this flap comes across without any tension on it, otherwise it's going to bow and get further from the grommet point, okay? If you put it on the ground and do it, you'll find out, like I did, that you can break the cypress units. If there's a pebble or a rock or something in the carpet or something like that, you can actually crack and break the display. Or the housing can come across and you can break it too. And I've done it, so I'm just sharing that with you so you guys don't. Anybody in here wash the cypress unit? Yep, I've done it. I mean, you can, you know, do silly things. So hold it off the ground and give it a tap. You'll find that much easier. Now, this next little tip. This next little bit, which we've done in a few minutes, is I learned this in California. With the skyhook only, there's a lot of tension on this cable when you're trying to put the pin in. It gets pretty frustrating. So the easy thing is to do this, is just take the hand about the pocket, and now the cable can go where it wants. It doesn't fight the pin. It helps immensely. But you should... Where is it? There, thank you. You should cover up the hook Velcro because it will damage the harness. This will help you, but do not forget to put it back in because I've done that too. Okay, so, actually, it goes that way. That's why I was having a hard time. So take the pin flap, bring it up. Any questions?
Test,
these come out at 23.6 every time. Yeah, just over. Actually, I got a scale. We can get it out, but it's in America, so I have to go back and get it. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't jump them. Okay. Get my contact lens right before it all goes pear-shaped. Here we go. So, come on. Yeah, please. Can you hold that set, Chris? Just this one. Now I got it. Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Gently and slowly pull out the pull-up cord. I actually cut mine every time at some path because we have miles of it, but I know you guys can't do that. But you know, friction creates heat, heat creates damage. Just take your time as you bring that out. Always pull away the way the pin's going. You can put it towards you and you can pop the container. I didn't mention, when you close the last flap, keep your face out of the way, because if you damage that loop at any point, or it's stressed and it decides to break, you're gonna end up wearing this in the face because the spring's right behind it. So keep your face out of the way as much as you can. I have, I've done it all. You pack as many as I've done, you actually break a lot of things, including yourself. Okay, so here, what I do is I do a little pull with my hand, a little twist, and feel the pin move. I know that if a small girl in the field is like an A14, 100-pound girl, she can pull that, no problem at all. We do a lot of checking per month on what the load on the pin is, and it really doesn't really exceed 22, to be honest with you. It's and about 19, 17 to 20, it really is. Because that comes up a lot in the classes we give. So before I go too far, I'm actually going to put the reserve ripcord handle back in the pocket, because I don't want to get excited about my beautiful pack job, then it pops. Yeah, never done it, but I don't want to do it here. Okay, so from here, take your temporary pin, and you can just pop that up, slide that under. Do you know why there's a piece of Velcro here holding this lanyard in place? Any ideas why it's there? No. Okay, if there wasn't, when you actually activate the reserve, you're going to pull the pin to the housing and it's going to lock. Even though the pin is 85 millimeters away from the grommet and the reserve is already coming out and you're doing great, you actually go, ooh! And just that thought in your head of being stopped is probably pretty scary. So what this does, it hesitates and the pin slides out of the marine eye. It's called a marine eye, so it just slides out. You continue to pull through. That's why it's there. Okay. Now, the final part is again, and Chris, you're quite right. I mean, I think it's much neater to do it beforehand. If you take the I've got the tension crease, so it's not going to come out.
It's folded kind of like that.
Yeah.
So they're nicely stuck down.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you do kind of see like a little bit of stuff work its way up.
For sure, yeah. Come back in.
I guess it depends on the general tension of the patch.
Yes, it does. What I do is I cover the mesh because the mesh has got friction, so I want to use the F111 to push and slide against. I'm going to push my S-fold up against the A&E, this flap here, over the bridle, and then down into the hole, which we made earlier. It looks quite, you know, barbaric, and you know, it's not as neat as Chris's, but it works really well. So, make an S-fold, cover the mesh. Here's my S-fold. I'm going to push towards my body so the rig doesn't go away from me. I'm going to push it in. Up, let's see, I'm going up. You can feel it over the bridle into that hole, which is back here, and gently start to work it into the hole. Behind this tension crease, you see the tension crease? So nothing can come out past that because it's gone down because the loop's the right length, and we thought about that at the beginning of the pad job. Okay, turn the rig around. Do the same thing on the opposite side. Cover the mesh, make an S-fold, slide it under, up, over the bridle, feel it go into the middle. And again, take a few things in this class and try it. Don't change everything because you'll find it's too much and it'd be overwhelming. Behind the tension crease. Then the last thing you want to do is put the rig on its side. Take your metal paddle, not a wooden one, because you'll break it, and just fan the sides, make it nice and square. Do the same on the opposite side. And that's how we pack the javelin at some part. Okay, you guys have any questions?
Have you done this before?
Sorry to run late. I'm so sorry. I am actually, sorry. Any questions, guys? I'll be in the hall. I'll be here all night if you have any questions. I've got business cards if you need them. We're available on Skype, email. You can call me. Any help you need, we're happy to help you. But that's pretty much what we do every time. Okay, thank you for coming. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.